I started a business pretty young, a little bit more than 18 years ago when I was 22. I started selling a computer on a small apartment, I think 500 meters from here on Magheru Boulevard. I started to discuss with the customers. I love talking with people. I love building process, and also I love technology. And all that principles I iterated a lot during my career. And at one point, I had a chance to buy eMAG in 2009. That was almost 8 years ago. eMAG at that time was a small e-commerce company focused on IT with a revenue, monthly revenue less than 2 million euros. I immediately left my companies that I founded, and I started to manage eMAG because I had the dream to using technology to start crossing borders, to start selling everything, to start building a company very fast that can reach 1 billion. And from the very first moment, I started to sell this dream inside the company that we will sell one day 1 billion per year, okay. And yeah, of course, everybody said, okay, you are crazy. We had a lot of issues. We have a tiny warehouse. We have a lot of problems, customers not happy. But step by step, by setting a very ambitious vision, and after that setting a very good mission towards the customers, we started to grow, and we started to grow pretty fast. If you want to be the leader in your field, you have to go deep in all the stack of technology you are using, and also you have to control as good as you can the entire supply chain. An e-commerce business is pretty complicated business because there are many verticals that should be integrated. So you have the suppliers, and the suppliers have the products, and you have to connect with suppliers. So for that, you need to understand the commerce. So e-commerce is just an addition, so some technology on top of commerce. So you have to understand commerce, how to connect with suppliers, how to negotiate, how to sign good contracts. After that, you have to understand the technology, so all the platforms, mobile, desktop, and everything. After that, you have to know logistics, so warehousing, courier business. And after that, you have to understand customer service, what the customer are doing, what is the journey of the customer when they are buying something, how does social, how does internet, how does, I don't know, traditional media influence the customer journey. And this is a journey different category by category. So if you want to sell fashion, this is more impulse product. If you want to sell TV, for example, this is a 10-day decision-taking process, and the customers are going back and forth, online, offline, different interactions. So all in all, if we want to understand and if we want to be profitable by doing this, let's say, I can say, standardized, is not yet standardized, is still early for saying that, but if we want to do this business like, I don't know, Amazon, JD in China, or big players all around the world, we have to go deep and understand everything and build our own stack of technology. And we build technology behind everything, so behind negotiation with supplier, pricing, supply, warehousing, delivery management, communication. All in all, we have 55 applications connected behind that are, let's say, the solid base for the business. And I can add that only for this peak season, in terms of, let's say, physical warehouses, we have 100,000 square meters. That means 100 per 1 kilometer. So this is huge warehousing space, and we'll ship. We'll have days when we'll ship 150,000 packages per day. So huge.
It's a lot.
Huge volumes. We are considering ourselves as a tech company, but in the same time, understanding the commerce is really important. I saw a lot of e-commerce companies that are saying, okay, we are pure technology company. And they don't understand commerce, or they don't understand logistics. And by doing this, you are losing, and you can be profitable if you don't understand the business end to end. So it's a technology powered business, but at the end is commerce. It's the same old commerce. This is the right domain, and this is the right industry to put your efforts in, to put your money. Because for sure this will grow. If we are looking at the rates of growth globally, e-commerce is growing more than 10% year on year. If we are looking at emerging markets globally, e-commerce is growing more than 20% year on year. If we are looking, for example, big players, Amazon is growing close to 30% year on year. JD in China, which is, let's say, our model, they are growing with 50% year on year. So definitely there is growth. My suggestion is, like we did, and like we are doing with everything we are starting, start small. So start from a niche where you have control and you have a differentiator. Either you have a very good supply. So if you supply, I don't know, something fashion, shoes, whatever, if you supply some niche products for home or for sport or something, so start from something small, or start to differentiate from the way you are talking with customers, so from the way you are engaging with them socially, or from a service that you are offering, I don't know, 1 hour delivery. So you are delivering yourself and you are pampering the customer. But start with something where you are differentiating. If you want to compete in together with all the big ones, it will be extremely difficult, because a startup don't have the power to go deep in the stack of technology. They have to use technology existing in the market, and for that they are paying a higher price than, for example, we are paying for our in-house built technology where we are scaling, because we developed our technology, proprietary technology, and we are paying less per order as they will pay as a startup when they will use an existing technology. So for that, you have to start small and to have a differentiator, and build on that differentiator, and from that, sky's the limit. One mistake can be by not involving the team in building the company. So trying to build on their own. I did that mistake, and I found out when I was exhausted, and when I was around 25, 26, I was pretty sick. I was in hospital for 2 weeks because I didn't delegate. So from that moment, I started to think, okay, I need to trust people, and I changed myself, and I started to trust people, to give them power, and give them responsibility. And I can say 95 is difficult to say, of the people we are interact with, they have good intention. So if you give them trust, and if you give them responsibility, they will try to do their best, and you just have to teach them, to show them the way. It will be difficult to build from one person who is leading the business, who's doing everything, to a big company where you have a management that will work like a human body, brain, and everything. This is difficult, and this must be done based on principles and based on trust. This was one of my mistakes, and I found the hard way. After that, another mistake is to try to do something, many things in the same time. So this is important to choose very maybe tiny niche, maybe something where you can really differentiate and start to build small. If you try to build something big from the very first day, you can do mistakes. Also, I did that, and it cost me a lot of money and time, and it was very painful when I started to do a lot of things in the same time, and I failed, and I learned from that, and I came back, and I did what I was very good at, and I strengthened the core of my business, and after that I started to build again. It took me some years, but I think regarding learning, business is a life learning experience. So you never stop learning about, I don't know, the core of your business, new technologies, but also about people. So I'm fascinating. Every day I'm learning something new. I found out that there is a lot more things to learn. And it's not possible to grow without learning and without changing yourself. So if you want to change the world of, I don't know, a small part of the society or something, you need to change yourself and you need to understand all the others. I think there are three things that will not change in a customer behavior 100 years from now. First, the customer wants products or services. Yeah. So, if you want to do commerce or e-commerce, you need to have products available, and the right products desired by the customer. Even it sounds simple, when you start to add products on your platform, you need to have the right one in front of the customer. So in order to do that, you need to understand the customer behavior, you need to look at the product page viewed by the customer, the interest of the customer, the engagement, time spent, and so on and so on. Second one is the price. So the customer is asking for a good price. And price is something I will not call a differentiator. We didn't use price as a differentiator. We used price as a hygienical positioning. So you need to have the right price for the customer. And the third one is convenience, or we can call service, or delivery time plus return service. So the customer wants a very fast delivery and a very good service of, I don't know, return after sale services. So three points will not change. And by rise of internet, millennials, changing of habits of new generations, e-commerce will just boom. So there is only one way, that is, and for a long time. Yeah, so we have a pretty big and clear road in front of us. For sure there are some obstacles, but e-commerce will grow because the customer desire this, because they are feeling value in e-commerce. E-commerce is saving time and money for the customer, executed correctly. And second point regarding the countries is pretty nice story. So in Bulgaria, it was a logical decision. So we looked at the map and we saw Bucharest is in, if we put Romania and Bulgaria together, Bucharest is in the middle. We have operations in Bucharest, the warehouse, good inventory, nice range of products, so we can start selling those products in Bulgaria. It was not very well planned, so we started with the front end and back end system decoupled, so we started taking orders on a Magento platform in Bulgaria, and after that manually putting them in the back end in Romania and delivering them from Romania. And after that we build our integrated system and make it multi-language, multi-offer, multi-VAT and so on. After that we said, okay, we want to go to Moldova because it's the same language and okay, we want to go to Moldova is something also that we were willing to do. We went there for a month, we studied the market and everything, and we came back and said it's not possible, it's so corrupted in the market, everything is with cash, so if you want to buy products from a distributor or from somebody, you're going with cash, you're going, I don't know, Euro, US dollar, whatever currency you have, they are accepting. If you are asking for invoice, they are charging you 4% more. So, and we decided we are not going there; it's too dangerous. And we said we even took one guy. We had this guy was product manager in our company, very very ambitious, very smart, and is a Moldavian guy. And we assigned this for Moldova, and after that we say, hey, we told you that you will run a country, what if we'll start Hungary? So Hungary was not, let's say, logical, rational, very well planned decision, and we started Hungary. And because of this guy and because also our support with technology and everything, Hungary is working very well. And Poland came from my partner, from Naspers. They had this company and they gave me this company to run. Yeah.